I would like to just say a word about my background and my general approach. I'm primarily a historian, supposedly. A historian of cultures. But the more I've studied the human process, or the human venture, the more it has taken me back to cosmology, to the universe in which humans live, to the culture of the planet, or to the living world, to what in general I would call cosmology. It's a very important thing with me as regards where we begin. Do we begin with psychology? Do we begin with sociology? Do we begin with theology? Or do we begin with the arts, or what? Where do we begin? And I have myself tried to begin where things begin, to begin at the beginning, which is somewhat strange, of course. But when we talk about anything, whether we talk about law or religion or economics or art or whatever, the primary reference is, to me, the universe in which we live, the cosmology, the universe. The word cosmos itself means order, an ordered universe, a meaningful universe. And so if we talk about art, a person looks at a leaf of a tree, or the flight of a bird, or the waves on the lake. Art, splendid, glorious art. We look at the stars in the sky. We look at the rabbit running through the fields. We look at the blossoms of the dogwood tree. We look at the wonderful structure of the spruce. Art. How magnificent. We look at the contours of the mountains. And we think about awesome and wonderful things. And so I would like to begin there. I would also like to begin with what is happening to the arts of the world and the conditions of art. This, I would say, is the condition of all art, is the vision of this magnificent planet, Earth. Such a precious planet. And when I consider that the conditions of art are being extinguished, it bothers me considerably. I'm bothered by a lot of things. I'm bothered, strangely, by the fact that I like air to breathe and water to drink and soil that can grow healthy food and so forth. And I'm somewhat disturbed by the fact that when I can no longer breathe the air or drink the water or eat the food and so forth, it bothers me. So with art. If we lived on the moon, and this constantly is in my mind, if we lived on the moon, our sense of the divine would reflect the lunar landscape. Our emotions would be as desolate as the moon. Our imagination would be as empty as the moon. Our feelings would be as negative as the lunar landscape. So that we have to be very much aware of the planet and the grandeur of the planet on which we live and how precious it is and how much it conditions not only our sight and so forth, but our psychic conditioning. Now we sometimes say we return to ourselves. Well, what can you return to you in yourself that hasn't been given to us by the glorious planet Earth? We are a product of the air and the water and the soil. the sunshine. And this, not only in our physical being, but in our psychic structure and in our intelligence. Without the grandeur of the planet Earth, even our thoughts would be limited and very stunted in their development, because even our thinking would be diminished. We wouldn't even have words, because our very limited number of words, if we lived on the moon, because there is nothing to name, or very few things to name. And so, when we think about anything at the present time, our first reference as regards the reality and value, I would suggest, must be the planet Earth. Now, there are three sentences that I sometimes use to describe our present situation of the 20th century. It's very simple, and some of you have heard before, but it's worth repeating. In the 20th century, the glory of the human has become the desolation of the earth. Second sentence. The desolation of the earth has become the destiny of the human. Third sentence. All human institutions, programs, and activities must be judged primarily by the extent to which they inhibit, ignore, or foster a mutually enhancing human-Earth relationship. Now, whether we're talking about law, or medicine, or art, or religion, no matter what we are talking about, the primary referent, the primary concern has to be the relationship of the humans to the functioning of the planet Earth, because we're nothing without that. Neither religiously, as regards our sense of the divine, nor in discipline of conduct, nor in economics, nor in our quest for health, nor in anything else. We are so totally involved and so totally dependent upon what happens to our surroundings. And so I would like to begin, or this is kind of an extensive introduction to my deep concern. Because, and the reason is this, that we have not been kind to the earth, and what is happening to the earth is to a large extent irreversible. It will never be healed. The extinction of species will never be healed, certainly not in human historical time. The carbon dioxides that we're putting into the atmosphere will never disappear, certainly in human historical time. The toxins in the organic structures of the earth will never disappear in human historical times, and the toxics in our own body. And the third world is very interesting. The toxicity in the blood of third world peoples is twice that in industrial societies. And because when they use our pesticides and so forth, they use them with a certain lack of the type of discipline that we have been able to use, so that there are some great problems. So what I want to do tonight is to take you through Dante's Divine Comedy, to take you through the Inferno, and then hopefully through the Purgatorio, and then to give you a glimpse of the Paradiso. But first, the Inferno. Well, some of you pass these out. And Dante's great poem is something that is a remarkable thing. I would like to say a word about this. The first thing we should look at is this. Action is urge to save species. This was a conference in Washington last year, September, in the late part of September. A conference was held on the future of life on Earth by the National Academy of Sciences and the Smithsonian Institute. And they had there the finest of the biologists that were available. I don't know how far they went, but certainly what is available in the States. And they had a very extensive inquiry into the future of life on Earth. Now, I would like to, there's something I'd like to say about this too. September the 28th, 1986 is a very important date. Two things happened on that date. This report came out on that day, and the meeting in Assisi took place on that day. That is the first meeting of the religious communities of the world, or the organized, or the classical, or the institutional. Well, some of them are not so institutional, but five of the classic religious traditions had a pilgrimage. And the wonderful thing about this was that the religions themselves did not organize it. It was the World Wildlife Fund that organized it, and it had decided on their 25th anniversary that they could not fulfill their objectives without contact with the religious traditions of the world. The religious traditions of the world, strangely enough, have had almost no concern for the planet Earth. That's one of the significant achievements of the Cathedral of St. John the Divine, that it's the only center that I know of that has taken the destiny of the planet Earth seriously, that is, within a religious framework. Now, the World Wildlife Fund, which is the largest of all the wildlife, the human nature establishments on an international scale, has took the initiative in establishing this contact. And they not only established this contact to have a five-day pilgrimage, it's what Dean Morton was there and Steve Dunn, where some of the people walked for 5 days and converged on Assisi from different points in Italy and established this discussion of human-Earth relations to reflect on it and to make a statement of repentance for what humans had done to them. The first time that I know of, in any significant way, that the churches had shown any interest, or the religions. So it was a very important thing. And in fact, after that meeting, the World Wildlife Fund, certainly in its British, I don't know if it was universal or not, but I think it was, changed its name to the Worldwide Fund for Nature, and established a publication on conservation and religion. It wasn't a religious initiative. It was the World Wildlife Fund established a publication called The New Road. And the purpose of it is announced in its subtitle, For Conservation and Religion. Now, this is one of the most hopeful things that has happened that I know of in recent years. Because, and that, when I come to the more positive aspect of things, I would like to put a certain emphasis on this, because the religions are on the verge of awakening. Our meeting here is one of the significant things, and what is done here, and what we have done here in the last 7 or 8 years, is the only other center that I know of in a religious context. Well, there is one other center, Osabo, in Michigan. And I'm not sure whether it's Lutheran or, do you know Osabo? They have a real program, a training program on the scientific ecology in relationship to religion. And it runs on an academic scale throughout the year. It's the other place that I know of that does significant work. And we had there, again, the World Bank held a conference there 2 or 3 years ago, I guess it was 2 years ago, on economics, ecology, and religion. So, but what happened on that same day, September 28th, 1986, was this report in the New York Times. Now, from my standpoint, this is where everything begins. I think this conference, which was a very serious conference, which brought to bear the best of our scientific knowledge of what's happening on the planet to evaluate where we are. And that is, by all odds, the most important thing to do. A medical person, before they deal with a medical situation, must diagnose it. And they must not falter in facing the reality of the illness, because that is what we've been doing. We have so far, and that's why I get in trouble a lot of times, and I talk to people sometimes, and I gave an hour and 15-minute lecture at one of the universities, Villanova University, about 300 people, and after I got through, they were so paralyzed they couldn't talk. But it's a kind of a, but it's about as stark as Dante. Now, if Dante were around, he'd probably really have a shattered. But this, he did the best he could for his time. But but here we have the total impact of things from with all this effort, with all this knowledge, trying to tell us, you know, what's happening. And so, you have E.O. Wilson from Harvard, and Paul Ehrlich from Stanford. Then you have one of the people I think is one of the best around these days, Norman Myers, who did an extraordinary book called Gaia, An Atlas of Planet Management, just a superb work that everybody should have. Now, because everybody now, without exception, must be interested in the subject. It's just like being on the Titanic. A person has got to be interested in what happens to that ship. And the difficulty was that nobody paid attention. But E.O. Wilson, Norman Myers, Lovejoy, these are the people that have studied this for 10, 20, certainly Ehrlich has studied the issue for 20 years or more. He wrote the basic book on extinction. But going back to E.O. Wilson, he did that remarkable study of sociobiology, and he's written several things, Biophilia, which is a magnificent study. Now, he tells us that we are losing 10,000 species each year and increasing. 10,000 species. These are not individuals, but species. We only know, it says in this, it says we know 1,600,000 and possibly 1,700,000. It's estimated that there are 5 to 10 million species, because we people that go to the tropical rainforest just continue finding species after species after species. But as the rainforest disappeared, as the grandeur of those woodlands disappear, all these species disappear. Vast numbers of species, 10,000 a year, species irrevocably, irreversibly disappear. And it's, if a person wanted to talk economics, it's an enormous loss to health because our medicines come so largely from these various forms of life. And in many, some parts of the world, that's what the medical or pharmaceutical companies do. They send people to these areas, to South America. They did a lot within Colombia and I know in the Philippines to find out what are the native medicines the people use. They find out their value. They come back and commercialize it and discover new approaches to the illness. Well, you can approach it economically, medically, in any way a person wants, poetically, religiously, any way you want. And to lose 10,000 species a year and not to be screaming mad at it is a question. Now, Norman Myers, this is down at the end of the first column, a consultant on environment and who is the expert in the tropical rainforest, who did his book on called The Primary Source, which is on the rainforest of the world. It said that we are an impending extinction spasm was likely to produce the greatest single setback to life's abundance and diversity since the first flickerings of life almost 4 billion years ago. Almost 4 billion years, nothing so significant has happened in the course of life. It's a rather impressive statement. Now, up at the top of the page. Other speakers said the current rate of species extinction caused by human activities was paralleled only in major geological and climatic upheavals that changed the Earth in the distant past. And that is what I have been suggesting for a long time. It is that we are not in a period of historical change or cultural modification. We're into something vastly different from that. We're into a situation where we are changing the structure of we're changing the chemistry of the planet, we're changing the biology of the planet, we're changing even the geology of the planet on a scale that took hundreds of millions and billions of years to bring into existence. And the sequence of life that has brought about the present beauty and splendor of life has taken billions upon billions of experiments, endless processes, to attune, the fine attunement of the various species of life is just astounding, the fine attunement. And to disturb that is kind of an ultimate difficulty that we put ourselves. Then we have a little further down, where I've checked a little further down, Paul Ehrlich suggests that humanity will bring upon itself consequences depressingly similar to those expected from a nuclear winter. He warned, including famine and epidemic disease. And this is, again, a shattering statement. Then toward the end, Ehrlich said, to look for technology for the answer to the loss of biological diversity would be a lethal mistake. He said that some steps could be taken to ameliorate the crisis, but that what was needed is a revolution in attitudes toward other people, human numbers, and so forth. And then he says, scientific analysis points curiously toward the need for a quasi-religious transformation of contemporary cultures. And that is a major part of my own presentation, or my own evaluation of it, is that we must create a new meta-religious consciousness. None of our existing religious cultural traditions can deal with this issue. They were not constituted to do that. They were constituted, many of them, for interior experiences. Many were for a sense of personal transcendent deity. But they were not constituted to deal effectively with our relationship with the planet. And what is needed now is a new sense of that. So that is the basic statement that I would like to make, but then I would like to go on with reflections now. What I suggest is that when we are this far disturbed in our cultural traditions, our socio-cultural traditions, that we must go back to something prior to our cultural traditions. We have our cultural coding and what we call genetic coding. Genetic coding is what I have been talking a lot about recently. I have given a number of talks about genetic coding. Every cell in our bodies carries the genetic coding, but our genetic coding encodes us psychically as well as physically and biologically. For instance, we are coded to speak genetically. We're genetically coded to produce a transgenetic cultural coding that provides the human quality of life, and also it's something that's handed on not by genetic continuity, but exactly, but by education. That's why humans have to be educated over such a long period of time. It only takes 9 months to bring us into our early infancy. But then it takes a long period of cultural development to give us our shape as humans. So, but we are genetically mandated to do that. Speech, for instance, we're genetically mandated to speak. How we speak is human invention, human choice, human determination. We're genetically mandated to live in society. How we do that, that's we determine that by our cultural choice. But we're genetically mandated to do it. The same with what I would call the basic things of life, the basic tendencies that we have, the attractions of men and women to each other. That's a genetic inheritance. And it's something more than physical attraction. It is also a psychic attraction. It's a genetic development. Now, how we relate and how we constitute our marriages and so forth, that is what we work out, and in some cultural context. But we are genetically mandated to do it. We're not free to do it or not to do it. We are free as to how we do it. Now, what is also important in this, and where the psychic element comes, and where the tendency to artistic expression is a genetic mandate. How we do it is our choice, and it's determined by the different cultural developments. But we are mandated to produce artistic expression. We are mandated to so many things. But also, a person can say that the archetypal world that Jung talked about is handed on biologically, and when this person says genetic, a person says biologically, although it's something more than biological. Coding, by definition, is psychic. There's a psychic coding for the birds, for the trees, for everything. There's a psychic component. So that it is not, there's nothing that's pure matter, and no living form that's pure. That's pure biology, as we say, and something of a pre-consciousness. There's no such thing as pre-consciousness in that sense. There's pre-human consciousness, but there is the consciousness and there are the instincts. How does a monarch butterfly know how to make its migration from here to Mexico to a certain special valley, to a certain special place, almost to a certain special plant? It's psychically coded. It never was there. It was born here. It knows where to go. It's like, how does the salmon, after being at sea for years and years, find its way back precisely to the place where it was born? It's psychic coding. Now this, the human also has profound instincts, profound tendencies. It's what guides us ultimately. Ultimately, we're not guided specifically by our cultural coding, but by our genetic coding. Now, and this is the problem of Western civilization. A person asks, how is it that we have been so destructive to the planet Earth that we're bringing, that we are closing down all the basic life systems of the planet, the water system, the air system, the land, the soil system, we're closing all those down. Now, some here and there, there's been some improvement. On the whole, things are worsening. Now, how can we do that? How can an industrial age pour such enormous poisons into the thing and call it progress? And call it progress. Why? Because we are into a profound cultural pathology. It's the most profound cultural pathology that has ever existed or ever could exist. I sometimes describe psychologically where we are in four words. All our institutions, all our professions and institutions are counterproductive at a basic level. That's why our education institution, the best things happen in education, not happening in our educational institutions, they're happening outside. Health is largely determined by the new emphasis on nutrition, on exercise, on peace of mind and the activation of inner processes and so forth. That did not come out primarily out of medical schools. That came out of the non-professional world. And in fact, across the board, the solution of our issues lies with the non-professionals. Now that's why it's very important not to be intimidated by professionals. It's very important. It's also very important to listen to the professionals. It's not that we can't do without the professionals. If we try to do without them, that's a madness too. But the important thing is that we have to do that what they have been telling us for a long time has not been adequate. Something like the scientists, somebody saying, oh, look at all the scientists have done and all that. The scientists have betrayed us twice over and are about to betray us a third time. The first extensive betrayal has been, and this requires a lot of further addenda to it, but a person could say at least two dominant things in our agricultural system. The scientists were going to tell us how to grow food on the plains and so forth. And now we find that what they were telling us has given us the most atrocious agriculture ever invented. Second thing they betrayed us on was in the nuclear power industry, which simply as economics is disaster. So that, and it's considered the most, the greatest failure of the managerial process that has ever taken place. Now the scientists are about to betray us by biotechnologists. When they, and particularly in terms of engineering the next generation through controls over the processes of conception, birth, and so forth. So that, and also by their altering, interfering with, and radically distorting the various animal species. Now a person can patent these. It's one of the most atrocious things ever, is the patenting of seeds and the patenting of these altered animal forms. Atrocious seeds. I was in the Philippines not so long ago, and in these third world countries, what is being done is that seed companies are putting out this these hybrid seeds that, with a lot of fertilizer and with a lot of irrigation, can of course produce for a couple of years or two or three years, can produce enormously. And then they have to be renewed by further hybridization and so forth. But they get a patent on those seeds. And then those seeds take over, and the great diversity of genetic strains is abandoned and die out, except that the very clever people take these abandoned genetic strains and they bring them back here and they cultivate them here, and then third world countries will have to buy back their own grains because they're copyrighted. Already, if you examine the genetic basis of the grains on which humans depend, you would find that we have a very, very restricted basis for our food supply. Whereas before, the genetic strains of rice, of wheat, of potatoes were so fantastic. Peru had 1,000 different strains of potatoes at one time. The great famine of the last century in Ireland was caused, one of the great causes was that they had only 2 genetic strains. And when the rust gets to them, there was no backup area. So that our corn, our wheat, and so forth, if you examine the basis, it's a very restricted basis. At one time, the humans ate over 1,000 different foods. Now there are 14 basic foods, and that is putting an enormous strain on a narrow basis. Well, I don't want to go too far into this, but to alert people or to make people aware of what the professionals can do to us and what they are doing to us and what the corporations are doing to us and what we must be very watchful about. But going back though to the basic thing that I wanted to talk about is the coding, the genetic coding and the cultural coding. What we have done is to turn, in Western civilization, is to turn our cultural coding against our genetic coding. Cultural coding is taken, it must be, and a further elaboration of genetic coding, not the frustration of the genetic coding, because these basic instincts that we have that are the human order, what the nest-building instincts are to the birds, or what the various instincts are to the various animals and so forth, our instincts are there, and they are further elaborated and enter into a consciousness phase that is not to mitigate them, but to elaborate them. But we have turned our cultural coding against our genetic coding. Now let me give you some rather sharp things. I don't know if we're all afraid to go home tonight, so it'll be understandable. But take something, well, first of all, Thomas Huxley gave a rather famous lecture in 1893 called the Romanes Lecture. He was one of the most distinguished of the scientists at the end of the last century. And one of his statements there, and it was built on ethics and civilization as a general subject, and he And he said, civilization must be judged by the extent to which it frustrates nature at every step. Strange definition. By the extent that we are civilized, in proportion that we diminish or go against the natural processes. Now, also Freud in his Civilization and Its Discontents has a passage where he says that the dread external world can be dealt with by the individual only by, in some manner, standing aside from it, or by joining with the larger community and through technology and science and technology, conquering the natural world and controlling it. So in both instances, we have this idea that a person conquers the natural world. And it reminds a person of this, the whole attitude on this continent, and we on this continent are something of the epitome of a lush continent, a fertile continent, that we were determined to subdue. And you get this in the literature. It's why the literature of America is largely dealing with this issue. It's the Moby Dick, for instance, which is one of the greatest novels ever written. It's the determination of Ahab to destroy the white whale. And that has all that it was the great problem of destroying the natural world in conquering it. And for in that instance, it was for sheer power and a certain madness that was recognized by Melville, that there is a pathology involved in this. Now also, Cooper, Fenimore Cooper, when he wrote Pioneers and the Leatherstocking Stories, he was already aware at the end of the 18th century, in the early 19th century, he was already aware that we were assaulting the continent. And he has one of the characters there as the woodcutter that just loves to cut down trees. It's a mystique of cutting down trees. And already there was somebody there protesting and saying, you can't do that so much. You've got to mitigate this clearing of land, because in the end it's just going to have a ruined world. So it's not that this is new. It's been recognized. So that when I describe this, it's there, but we have not learned. We have not really read Moby Dick. We have not really read Cooper. We have not really read Mark Twain. Huckleberry Finn, for instance, where he gives this the raft, where Huck and the slave are there on the raft, and describes this steamboat coming down and smashing the raft. It's that conquest of the progress over the simplicities of life and the closeness to the instinctive. That's why it's always appealed, but somehow we don't think. So what this has led to, and this I had a meeting just a few days ago with some very interesting people that work with us, and Pete Seeger, you may have heard of him, and does so much ballad singing and was dedicated to the preservation of the Hudson River, and John Cronin, who's the river keeper. Some of our places now in the States, we have what we call the keeper, a river keeper. I guess they had river keepers in England, or forest keepers and so forth, or wardens. And so we are reconstituting that. We have a Long Island, the Long Island Sound, a keeper for Long Island Sound. That is someone who watches it, who sees what's happening to it, and alerts people to damage being done to it, and gathers the information for the lawsuits that must be frequently invoked against those who violate it. So at this meeting, and they were discussing some of these issues, and a very dedicated group of people. There were 60, 70 people that worked with town councils to get the proper sense of land use. They were talking about, to some extent, the difficulty of dealing with town councils. Why? Because they're controlled by the developers, the construction people, the finance people, and the lawyers, who are all in league to exploit the land and to bring in industry and to do construction and to wipe out the forests and so forth. Well, they were saying that, and I thought for a while, let's listen. I decided that democracy is a conspiracy against the natural world. And the US Constitution is a conspiracy against the North American continent. It's a conspiracy. It's these humans trying to exalt themselves and establishing all their rights, but according their rights to property, their rights to exploit, their rights to happiness, in terms of, and implicitly, in terms of the devastation of the environment. Without, of course, they didn't know at that time when the Constitution was written, this anthropocentrism was a fixation in the glory of things, and we were supposedly the be-all and end-all of things, and we could do anything we want to, and the natural world was there. And it would be there forever. We could do anything we wanted to, and so forth. But if you look at it in a certain way, it can be seen from the standpoint of the natural world. How would a tree? I was describing once in an essay, I always thought it was the nicest little piece I ever wrote, about the when Henry Hudson, when his ship appeared on the horizon, that little shaft, that little mast appeared on the horizon before he sailed into the New York Harbor with the Indians here. I said, when that mast appeared, every living creature on this continent might have shuddered at the fate that awaited him. Every creature on the continent. But immediately, the beaver were exterminated in their area. Immediately, the great trees were doomed and so forth. Anyway, but there's one other word that's very important to get this concept. This is very important, because this is the analysis of the pathology. And we can't, this is the therapy. It's a painful therapy. But if we don't go through it, we are not going to undergo the depth transformation that is required. It'd be like an alcoholic. I started to give you those four words describing our situation in all our professions, institutions. They're counterproductive, addictive, paralyzing. That is, they're addictive in the sense to get out of it, we have to go through the agonies of withdrawal from drug addiction. They're paralyzing because we feel so helpless against it, and manifestation of a deep cultural pathology. So, going back to this, there's another word that's very important, is the word progress. And the word progress, it's a very difficult word. And we were talking somewhere, I've forgotten, the Marshall Plan and so forth. It was mentioned this evening, I believe, it's something about the Marshall Plan. Well, the Marshall Plan geared up the plundering economy of Europe, and in that sense, rebuilt the economy. But what was the real cost of rebuilding the industrial economy? The industrial economy was rebuilt. Now, there was a chance after the war to rethink, perhaps, and at that time, there was very little chance of rethinking the industrial economy. There were certain urgencies about what was being done, But there was a need to think this through at a more profound level of what is happening and the cost of what was happening. So, but going back to this other thing of progress, which is probably the most important single word in the Western culture for several centuries. Because we have seen all that we have done in terms of progress. We have progressed. And then a person says, but at what cost and what progression? To have so many automobiles, is that progress? Or maybe a few hundred automobiles and a few good roads, maybe so. But when you get hundreds of millions of automobiles, they destroy the planet. They destroy the forest. They destroy the air and so forth. So that, but progress, everything is, the more we consume, the more we do is progress. But my point here is that our cultural attack against the natural world and against our genetic coding. This is against the basic instincts that are given to us by the genetic process. Because the basic tendency that's communicated to us is one of relationship with the natural world, and it gives us a sense that progress has to be something where the birds progress and where the trees progress and the water progresses in its life-giving qualities and the air progresses in its life-giving qualities and so forth. And the difficulty is that we begin to think the human and we take the human seriously without taking the rest of the world seriously. And we talk about human society. Human society is pure abstraction. There's no such thing. There's only the society of the living, the society of the planet Earth. Human society has no meaning except in this larger context. It has neither existence nor meaning. But if we talk about progress, it must be progress of things. If we write a constitution, it should be a constitution for the North American continent. And if we have a democracy, it should be extended to become a biocracy. So that we need a biocracy, not a democracy. And in this context, we would be able to begin building the new world. Now, a few items. That's the inferno. A few items of a more constructive sort. If this is a position that can be defended or that our scientists are telling us about, what can we do? Analysis of the scientists is something that apparently people read and turn the page and say, what else is new? It's like on the Titanic, they found the icebergs up there and they said, well, what else is new? And so forth. And they keep sailing. So, coming back to what are the positive things, there is a movement, and here is where what we need are symbolic, archetypal personalities and acts and institutions. We need guidance that is creative in relationship with specific circumstances. Now, one of the most striking things, I put this thing on the back, it has to do with the Chipko movement in India. I don't know if you have heard of the Chipko movement. It was the movement of women that went out when the woodcutters came to destroy a forest, and they had reasoned that what was happening was an ecological disaster. So it was an ecological thing they were doing. When they went out And when the woodcutters came, they joined hands around the trees, it's called the tree huggers, and refused to let the woodcutters cut the trees unless they first cut them. So that they put their bodies there to stop the woodcutters. This was done in the early 1970s. It's called the Chipko Movement. It was, and there, this is the description of it. It's down in the on the right-hand side, where they were scheduled to be. The women tied sacred threads to the trees as a token of a vow of protection. Between 16th and 20th of December of 1977, large numbers of women from 15 villages guarded the forest while discourses on the role of forest in Indian life from ancient texts went on nonstop. It was here in Advani that the ecological slogan, "What do the forests bear? Soil, water, and pure air," was born. The axemen withdrew, only to return on the 1st of February in 78 with two truckloads of the armed trees. The plan was to encircle the forest with the help of the police and so forth. But before the police reached the area, the volunteers of the movement entered the forest and explained their case. By the time the contractors arrived, each tree was being guarded by three embracing volunteers. This is an archetypal, wonderful archetypal thing. They recognize that unless the trees were there, they wouldn't be there long. They recognize that the tree was part of the community and that the total community had to be sustained. And it's one of the most magnificent moments, I think, in modern history, I would say. This is taken from a larger account. It's about 6 or 8 pages, the account. It's taken from the complete thing from Mountain Research and Development, Volume 6, Number 2, 1986, and pages 133 to 142. Now this this is a kind of an archetypal moment. Now, also what we're witnessing is a vast change that's taking place. There are in the States now, or in the North American continent, 12,000 independent environmental movements. That's a large number. So that what is happening, I think, and I think right this year is enormously important. In fact, the meeting we're having here now, I think, can be associated with two other meetings of great importance that have taken place. The one is the meeting of the Green Movement in Massachusetts, which was to form a national green movement in the States. And one of the big issues, and they're a great difficulty, they had over 1,000 people there. They had over 100 different sections taking up all the different phases, all the particular phases of an integral program to act, not just generally, but to be present in all the different aspects that go together in the functioning of contemporary life. And that movement, and one of the most important things there, is the insistence on a spiritual basis for this movement. Now, one of the difficulties that could diminish the power of the movement is to reduce it to a substitute for a leftist type or Marxist type social movement, and to absorb it into a certain socio-political framework, but losing the impact of this deeper sense that the primary issue is the ecosystem and the human is secondary. And that's the big issue that we face. It's whether you put a primacy on sociological processes and try to develop an environment that's hospitable to those processes, or whether you say that the human must fit into the processes of the natural world, that the natural world is primary.